bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Welcome again to St. Andrew's. So today we're celebrating the Feast of Christ the King. And it's the last day of the church year. So the church year is coming to a close. It's a great way to end the church year because we proclaim Jesus as our King. The one who began in a humble manger in Bethlehem, that to come around and to be the King of all, to be the one that's highly exalted. This is a great way for us to wrap up the year. Of course, it also means that tomorrow, next Sunday, we start all over again with Advent as our beginning. The church year is a beautiful cycle that just continues and goes on and on. We begin with Advent as we prepare for Jesus' first coming. But think about a second. Born in Bethlehem, out and about, we have the Epiphany, the Word going out into all the world. Then it's the time of Epiphany, and then we come to the time where long, dry time of Lent that we all love so much. And then we end it with Easter in this joyful time in the Easter season. Then back around we come and we hit Pentecost where the church is born and we study and learn the longest season of the church. They used to call it ordinary time, but I think that gave people the idea they could take a vacation. So they changed it to the season of Pentecost. Scott calls it the green and growing season where we learn and work and struggle to be the church. Until we culminate that with this feast of Christ being King. And I love that idea. I ran out of time. I wanted to make a big like pinwheel thing with all those seasons you could spin. And as the season of the church repeats and repeats, it teaches us and we grow in our faith and we learn deeper. Because sometimes we miss it the first time. I don't know about you, but sometimes I hear things, the first 10 times and I don't get it, but I finally get it. But this wheel, like ancient cultures and a lot of traditional societies, view time as a wheel, that it just goes on. We have the seasons and things repeat. But that has a sense of hopelessness as we just spin and go nowhere. But the Judeo-Christian history or understanding is that wheel is not fixed on an axle that never moves. It's more like a bicycle wheel moving down the road. Yeah, that wheel is turning. But we're moving down the road. We're going somewhere. God has a plan for humanity, a plan for each one of us. And as we move forward and repeat, but we're going somewhere. We're going to this place where eventually Christ will be King in the world, in the church, in our own hearts. And I think it begins when we are able to make Christ King in each of our hearts. So when we think of Christ as King, it's a different kind of king. Like a lot of things in the gospel, it's different than what we've first thought of. I want to read a little story from the book called The Way of the Wolf by Martin Bell. It's an oldie but a goodie. The story I want to read is The Ragtag Army. So if you'll just kind of sit back for a minute, and not too long. The Ragtag Army. I think God must be very old and very tired. Maybe he used to look splendid and fine in his general's uniform, but no more. He's been on a march for a long time, And look at his ragtag little army. All he has for soldiers are you and me. Silly little army. Listen, the drum beat isn't even regular. Everyone is out of step. And there, do you see? God keeps stopping along the way to pick up one of his tinier soldiers who decided to wander off and play with the frog or run in a field or whose foot got tangled in the underbrush. He'll never get anywhere that way, and yet the march goes on. Do you see the marchers who have broken up into little groups? Look at that group up near the front. Now there's a snappy outfit. They all look pretty much alike. Well, at least they're in step with each other. That's something. Only they're not wearing their shoes. They're carrying them in their hands, silly little band. They won't get far before God will have to stop again. Or how about the other group over there? They're all holding hands as much as they march along. The only trouble with this is that the ones on each end of the line, pretty soon they realize that one of their hands isn't holding on to anything. One hand is reaching, empty, alone. And so they hold hands with each other, and everybody marches around in circles. The more people holding hands, the bigger the circle. And of course, a bigger circle is deceptive because as we march along, it looks like we're going someplace, but we're not. And so God must stop again. You see what I mean? He'll never get anywhere this way. If God were more sensible, he'd take his little army and shape them up. Why, who ever heard of a soldier stopping to romp in a field? It's ridiculous. But even more absurd is a general who will stop the march of eternity to go and bring him back. But that's God for you. He is no endless, empty marching. He is going somewhere. His steps are deliberate and purposeful. He may be old, he may be tired, but he knows where he's going. And he means to take every last one of his tiny soldiers with him. Only, there aren't going to be any forced marches. And after all, there are frogs and flowers and thorns and underbrush along the way. But even though our foreheads have been signed with the sign of the cross, we are only human. And most of us are afraid and lonely and would like to hold hands or cry or run away. And we don't know where we're going, and we can't seem to trust God, especially when it's dark out, and we can't see him. And he doesn't go on without us, though. And that's why it's taking so long. Listen, the drumbeat isn't even regular. Everyone is out of step. And there, you see, God keeps stopping along the way to pick up one of his tinier soldiers who decided to wander off and play with the frog, or run in a field, or whose foot got tangled in the underbrush. He'll never get anywhere that way. And yet, the march goes on. I like that story because it reminds me of the kind of king Jesus is supposed to be. Now, see, I often think our spiritual ancestors, the Jews of Jesus' day, misunderstood, got it all wrong, the idea of the Messiah, what the Messiah would be like. And so that makes me think that maybe we get it all wrong about the second coming, about Jesus being king, that we misunderstand. I mean, when we think of a king, what do we think of? We think of powerful, we think of fine clothing and palaces. We think of someone who's militant, who commands armies. And if we get on the wrong side of the king, it could go very badly for us. But Jesus isn't like that. Those aren't the stories that we get when we read the Gospels. Those aren't what the prophets tell about the Messiah. It's a Messiah of love. Remember, Jesus becomes king by being the lamb who is slain. By laying down his life, God highly exalts him. And so in the same way, it's by laying our lives down. It's by laying our pride down, laying down our feeling to be right, our need to be right, our dreams and visions, our opinions, our sense of self-importance. It's in laying those things down that we conquer. And when we conquer, Jesus conquers. You know, the point of the parable that we read today of the sheep and the goats, that very powerful parable, isn't about judgment as much as it is about learning to love and serve the least of these. See, if it's about judgment, that will just make us afraid, and we live a life of fear, and we're not free to do the calling and the work God has called each of us to do. And Jesus doesn't call us to be afraid, but calls us to follow and to follow in faith and peace. And so the point of that parable is to focus on the least of these. And it's a little bit different than just loving our neighbor. It's a larger call. It's a little bit different in that we are to seek out and serve the least of these, not just wait for them to come to us. And this church has a long, proud history of seeking out and serving the least of these, from the soup kitchen to the hospitality house to our outreach in the community, to our love of one another, to the taking pill bottles to Mexico, mission trip to Uganda, a long history of seeking out and serving the least of these. And that's something we can be excited about. Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, in what the Episcopal Church is calling the Matthew 25 Project, is asking us to fast, pray, and love. If you remember the movie Eat, Pray, and Love, he puts a little twist to it, says fast, pray, and love. And to discern how each one of us is called to serve, to seek out and serve the least of these. So how are we to do that? And then how are we as St. Andrew's, as a community, to seek out and serve the least of these? And I know it's not easy. We all get tired. We have a lot on our plates. We're busy, mostly with good things. That's why we want to, as we approach Advent and as we bring the 2017 church year to a close, we want to pause and fast and pray in love and listen to God. Where are you calling us? Where are you calling me? Where are you calling my family? Today, if you can't make it beyond that, even just today. Lord, how can I seek out and serve the least of these? And so we close out the year proclaiming that indeed Christ is King. In our hearts, in our lives, in our church, and someday in the world. But I pray that Jesus' kingdom is felt first and foremost by the least of these. Amen.